that we want to lift up before you, and then we will begin our worship too. We want to keep Kim Hansen and her family in our prayers. Her brother Curtis was badly burned earlier in the week, so we want to keep that family in our prayers. Dale Anderson was hospitalized earlier in the week, but he was at the last service, so we give God thanks for his recovery. We also want to keep Arla Gilbertson and his family in our prayers on the death of Leona. Her funeral was on Thursday. We also want to keep Harold and Rita McClintock in our prayers on the death of their son David. That funeral, I believe, is at St. Leo's on Tuesday. And then we also want to keep the family of Pastor Rudy Kempainen in our prayers. Pastor Kempainen died this morning. Easter blessings for him. Pastor Kempainen was the senior pastor when Pastor John at his first call. So close to home right now. So we will keep Pastor Kempainen's family in our prayers. On that note, I would invite the Sunday school children to come forward, as well as all the children to come forward with the children's message. And it doesn't matter, just grab one, okay? And then we're going to come back here, and this is what Then Pastor John is going to read the gospel, okay? And then we're going to say it again. And then when the music starts, there's going to be trumpets and the congregation's going to sing really loud. And we're going to take our banners and we're going to follow Jared and the cross. We're going to go out into the gathering area and walk around, and then we're going to come back up the aisle, okay? Can we do that? And the song that we're singing has the word Alleluia in it. Every time you hear the word Alleluia, stick your Alleluia banners up, okay? Can we do that? Good? All right, so go this way around, and Jared and Pastor John will help you get your banners, and then come back here. You guys who are on Sunday school, after you get your banners, you're going to...
crawled away from the tomb, but when they went in, they did not find the body. While they were perplexed about this, suddenly two men in dazzling clothes stood beside them. The women were terrified and bowed their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here, but has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee that the Son of Man must be handed over to sinners and be crucified and on the third day rise again?" Then they remembered his words. And returning from the tomb, they told all this to the 11 and to all the rest. Now it was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the other women with them who told this to the apostles. But these words seemed to them an idle tale, and they did not believe them. But Peter got up and ran to the tomb. Stooping and looking in, he saw the linen cloths by themselves. Then he went home, amazed at what had happened.
Christ is risen!
He is risen indeed!
Alleluia! We continue with the singing of hymn number 365. And by his glorious resurrection, you delivered us from the power of death. Make us die every day to sin, that we may live with him forever in the joy of the resurrection. Through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Also has come through a human being. For as all die in Adam, so all will be made alive in Christ. But each in his own order, Christ the first fruits, then at his coming, those who belong to Christ. Then comes the end, when he hands over the kingdom to God the Father, after he has destroyed every ruler and every authority and power, for he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Many of us with palm branches in hand, and we praise the coming of Christ. Hosanna to the Son of David, we proclaim. And then on Thursday, we gathered here again. This time, we sat around a table. And then on Friday, we gathered yet again. this time at the foot of the cross, to behold the form of the dying Christ on the cross. And now this morning, we join the women. We join the women as they come down to that tomb with one big exception, one big difference. We know something they don't. We know that the tomb is empty. We know that as we arrive, the stone has been rolled away and there is no dead body in that tomb. But the women didn't know that. They came down to the tomb expecting what was reasonable to expect, namely that there would be death in that tomb. And you can hardly blame them for that. They were there, they saw the crucifixion, they witnessed the Christ who hung on the cross and whose life ended. But more importantly, the women understand a basic, fundamental law of life. And that is, life can be ended by death, and life cannot overcome death. That is to say, death is more powerful than life in the end. And they know that to be true. They know it to be true. And so as they come down to the tomb, they are coming to a place of death where life no longer has any power. Now, they're not the only ones who think that way. If you go home after worship, go home, pull out your Bible, turn it to Luke 24, and get past the Easter story that we read this morning, that I read a few minutes ago. The very next passage, the very next verses, take us into a marvelous story. Luke is a great story writer. He's got this great story about two men, followers of Jesus, who are on their way to the village of Emmaus. They're on the road between Jerusalem and Emmaus. These guys understand reality too. They know the score. They know reality. They know what's happening. They were there too. They saw Jesus die on the cross, and they know too that death can end life, and life cannot change death. And so as they walk along that path, suddenly a stranger joins them. The stranger is Jesus. But they cannot recognize that. In part, because why would they expect Jesus to walk with them? Remember, Jesus is dead. Jesus is dead. And life can be ended by death. And death cannot be changed by life. And so they too expect death and do not see the presence of Jesus in their midst. But it's not just women who walk down to a tomb or men on their way to Emmaus. Sometimes it's you and me. You and me who live in a world in which we know that life is ended by death and life cannot change death. We know that to be a truth because we see it around us all the time. And so even though we come here this morning knowing that the tomb is empty, well, I don't know. Does that really matter? Does it really change anything? It's interesting in the second reading that Eric read, Paul says, if it is only for this life that we have hope, we are most to be pitied. And I understand where Paul is coming from. I get that. What Paul is saying is there's something bigger. There's something greater. There's something more to this story. I get that. But it is equally true that if the only thing we have to hang on to is that someday I'll go to heaven, doesn't Jesus have anything to do with me today? I mean, think about it. Tomorrow, you know, you wake up tomorrow and you face a world that is filled with all sorts of ugly stuff. All sorts of forms of death. Maybe it is death. The funeral that I hope I'll be able to attend later this week of a good friend and colleague. It will be a moment to explore and ponder the depth of death and how life is a part of death in the person of Jesus. But maybe it's not just the death of the body. Maybe it's declining health. Or maybe it's the doctor visit that's coming up. Maybe it's the relationship, the marriage, or other relationship that is crumbling before our eyes and we just don't know what we can do to stop it. Or maybe we don't even want to stop it. Maybe it's the bills we can't pay. Or maybe it's just simply life has kind of gotten into a rut. And I just don't really have a sense of where I'm going. I kind of feel rudderless, you know? I'm kind of drifting through life, don't really know where I'm going. But Jesus rose from the dead. Doesn't that fix everything? Not always. Because we know too. We know too that death is ended by life, or that life is ended by death, and life cannot change death. Life can't do that. So we too find ourselves like the women and like the men on the way to Emmaus. But remember what happens. The women come down to the tomb, expecting the tomb to be filled with death. And then the angel says to them, "Why are you looking for the living among the dead?" And moments later, they remember the Word of God. You know, when we think about the Word of God, we think about the Word of God in the person of Jesus. We're not just talking about, toner on a sheet of paper. We're not just talking about taking some letters and stringing them into intelligible phrases that make some sense. We're talking about God's power in our world, God's power to create, to make things happen, God's power to recreate, to renew, and to restore. We're talking about God being active, God getting his hands dirty in the midst of our journey of life. And so women, remember the Word. Remember the Word. Just like the two disciples. Remember those two guys going off to Emmaus? We were talking about them a few moments ago. These two guys on the road to Emmaus, and suddenly Jesus appears in their midst, but they do not recognize that it's Jesus. And they continue to converse with this stranger, not knowing who he is. And they finally arrive at Emmaus, and the sun is beginning to set. And because they are good, caring individuals, children of God, they invite the stranger to stay with them, because in that world, you do not want to be on the road at night. It ain't safe. So they invite him to stay with them. And they also invite him to join them for the meal. And so they sit down at the table together, and Jesus takes the bread and he breaks the bread. What does that sound like? Anybody know what that sounds like? It sounds like Holy Communion, doesn't it? He breaks the bread in their midst. Their eyes are open and they realize who he is. Martin Luther, building on St. Augustine, the 5th century church father, said, "The sacraments, especially communion, are God's word in visible form. The women, you see, remembered the word they had heard. The disciples on the road to Emmaus saw the word in their presence. They saw it, and faith and life was kindled in them as they suddenly realized that it's not always true that life is ended by death and that life cannot do anything about it, but that the power of life in the person of the crucified and risen Jesus changes the rules of the game and makes life possible where there should not be life. Makes hope possible where there is nothing to be hopeful for. Brings light into the midst of darkness. That's the gift of the crucified and risen Jesus, experienced by women on the road coming down to the tomb and by a couple of men on the way to Emmaus. And experienced by us too. Experienced by us when we remember the Word, not just the story, but the power of what God is doing in our lives. And when we see the Word in the sacrament, in the Word that is visible in our midst, in the breaking of the bread and the sharing of the cup, we experience that gift of life again. And we need to experience it again, because we live in a world that's kind of heavy. You know, kind of a heavy world here. It's a heavy-duty world. It's a very wearying world. It's a world that presses us down, that drains us, that leaves us empty again and again. And that's why we come back here. You know, the early Christians understood every Sunday to be sort of a mini Easter. And so we come back to this place to experience not just an empty tomb, but to experience the power of the Word. The Word that we hear, the Word that we see, the Word that we taste, the Word that we touch. And to be renewed and restored again and again. Because as human beings, you know, we get that little shot of adrenaline here, a little bit of extra boost. And we go out, we're kind of high because it's Easter and Jesus rose and there is life and He is risen indeed. Alleluia, the whole thing. And then we run into Monday morning. You know? Don't you think Monday morning shouldn't start till noon at least? Okay, that's why I was thought. But it doesn't. Monday morning starts tomorrow morning. And we go back to reality, back to real life. We run into the things that drain us, that pull us down. We run into the presence of death in many forms. But the Word is still there. And the Word is still here. So we remember the Word. And we return to this place or a place like it to be restored and renewed. To be recreated and refreshed. So that we can continue to be faithful disciples of Jesus. So we can continue to look ahead and know that at the end of time, there will be new life. There will be new hope. I was telling Pastor Gene that this colleague of mine, my dear friend Rudy, what better day to die than on Easter Sunday? For Rudy, it might have been Good Friday. He might have picked Good Friday if he had his druthers. But what better day to be here, to be in the midst the kingdom of God, and on the day we celebrate, God gives us life. So as we continue to journey now, as we go from this place, as we get worn down and weary, remember the power of God's Word in Jesus that restores us, that renews us, that refreshes us, brings us back to life, and that reminds us that in the end, life is not wiped out by death. Death cannot keep life, God's life, from renewing it and restoring it in all of us. Amen. We continue with the singing of Now the Green Blade Rises. If you are comfortable, would you please rise?
Oh,
all in need, that the whole world may know the resurrection that God promises to give. O God of life, pour the life of your Son's resurrection into the churches. Make visible the unity we have in you. Show to each denomination the strengths of the others. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Give to the lands and seas the life of your continuing creation. Water the flowers of springtime and nurture the growing crops. Bless all who protect your plants and animals. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Grant to all nations your life of peace. Keep us from war. Lead us into justice. Turn enemies into friends. We pray especially for the people of Belgium and Syria. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Visit the needy with your compassionate light. Feed the hungry, nurse the sick, protect the weak, comfort the sorrowful, attend the dying. Especially we pray for Curtis and Dale as they seek healing, and Leona's family, David's family, and Rudy's family as they seek comfort. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Raise up this assembly with the life of your Spirit. Reveal in our community the signs of Christ's resurrection. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
O God of life, we praise you for the faithful who have met you in death. Bring us all from death into the life of your resurrection. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
O God, we praise your life. We bless your mercy. We honor your power. Transform all that is dying with the joy of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us share that peace with one another.
Thank you.
heaven and earth. Day by day you shower us with blessings. As you have raised us to new life in Christ, give us glad and generous hearts, ready to praise you and to respond to those in need. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Piper made juice and wine. If you have need of grape juice or the gluten waivers, please just indicate that to the community assistant and we will gladly share that with you. For those of you who are guests and visitors, we do sincerely invite you to join with us. The table of life is spread before you. Feast on the goodness and mercy of God. Please be seated.
Thank you.
The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
We give you thanks, O God, that you make your home with us, bringing heaven to earth in this holy meal. Fill us with your spirit as we go from here, that we may wipe away tears, tend to those in mourning and pain, seek the healing of the nations, and bring to earth the presence of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
The blessing of the Lord God Almighty, the blessing of Christ, the Lamb who was slain, and the blessing of the Holy Spirit of truth be among you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Alleluia. Go in peace. Share the good news.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia.
The closing hymn is Alleluia.